like to go to our next speaker, again, Professor Hany Aly, and towards a neck free in ICU.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. So toward neck-free NICU. So the objectives that we'll cover is to visit new concepts for necrotizing enterocolitis classification based on pathogenesis and identify risk factors for NIC and provide the strategies to reduce NEC rates in the NICU. So because of the time constraint, we are not going to go over the basics of necrotizing enterocolitis and assume we all know about it anyway. So most commonly acquired life-threatening intestinal disease in neonates is necrotizing enterocolitis. It happens 1 to 2% of admission, but may occur up to 10%. 60% are medically treated, 40% are surgically treated. In these surgically treated, 50% mortality rate. Pathogenesis involves prematurity, interalimentation, bowel ischemia, infections, and toxins. So, risk factors, term versus preterm, indomethacin and PDA. So, does it really cause NIC or is associated with NIC? So, most probably no. Indomethacin may be associated with bowel perforation. PDA association with NIC has been most probably sorted out already. Vitamin E, maternal cocaine, prematurity less than 28 weeks of gestation, where 90% of cases happen, SGA, and presence of asphyxia and infection polycythemia. So you have also the hemodynamic instability, hypoxia, reperfusion injury, causing inflammations and cytokines, and then you have different cytokines. Why does it happen mostly in premature infants? Because of the immune system of the premature infant is different. And also they have a lower acid production that will cause overcolonization with bacteria and decreased activity of the proteolytic enzyme and the immature immune system, as we just mentioned. So is NIC really, is it a one disease, or it is a common pathway of multiple disease? So when you say somebody with acute respiratory failure, it can be because of meconium aspiration, can be because of surfactant deficiency, or it can be because of pneumonia. But at the end, you have a final picture. Retraction, tachypnea, oxygen requirement. So necrotizing enterocolitis is really something very similar to that. Somebody with distension, erythema, but where did it happen because of? So most probably there are multiple diseases, and we tend to lump them all together and say, oh, he has NIC. So if you would classify necrotizing enterocolitis according to pathogenesis, then you have a one entity motility related necrotizing enterocolitis. And you know, for premature infants, the neural, the innervation of the gut is start from above and from below simultaneously. So the a very early premature age, you have the vagal neural crest start to migrate, growing from craniocaudally, while the sacral crest colonize the gut from below to above. So at 24, 25 weeks, he may have some neurons in the duodenum and some neurons in the rectum, and in the middle there is no neuron yet. So the movement of the intestinal content is minimal before 30 weeks, and that's why we don't see meconium in the amniotic fluids unless the baby is close to term. So in the absence of asphyxia, 50% of premature infants, they will have their first stool after 48 hours. While term infants, they have a stool within 24 hours. Premature infants have absence or impaired rectosphincteric reflex. Therefore, they behave in a way very similar to Hirschsprung disease. And you have the motility-related necrotizing enterocolitis. Well, the pathogenesis will be you're feeding a baby who is not stooling. So the stool will accumulate in the colon, very similar to Hirschsprung, causing fermentation, inflammation, like toxic megacolon, and then the baby will have NIC. We did this study in 2004, looked to stool frequency on babies with NIC versus those without NIC. And you can see before the instance of NIC, 2 weeks before the baby was diagnosed with NIC, there is a significantly less frequency of stooling. So we do follow a policy for premature babies. If they don't have stool for 24 hours, we start to give rectal stimulation or glycerin suppository to enhance stooling at least once a day. And you can see the pathogenesis start if you have delayed adaptation of the intestinal mucosa for absorption, you have increased gastric residuals, then stasis of the undigested food, you start to have distension, then breakthrough the host defense, then now the baby starts to have some respiratory distress and apnea, finally breakthrough the mucosa and toxins released into the system, and that you have the metabolic acidosis and DIC. The second type of necrotizing enterocolitis is really infection. Infection-related NIC. So NICU outbreaks of the NICU, of the NIC, suggest infectious etiology. Many times babies with NIC, they have positive blood culture, and some response to antibiotic treatment. And of course, viral infection can be part of that infectious-related necrotizing enterocolitis. You have pro-inflammatory mediators increased in the cases of NIC, mainly platelet activating factors and different interleukins, and also the TNF-alpha. The third type of NIC is perfusion-related necrotizing enterocolitis, somebody with congenital heart disease, hypoplastic left heart, or also the being SGA or prematurity. They are all have any episodes of babies, multiple apnea and bradycardia, and these babies, they tend to have a perfusion, reperfusion injury. Does patent ductus arteriosus causes NIC? 15,000 babies reviewed in recent observational studies and showed there is no relationship between PDA and NIC. There's another study that involved only 6,000. They showed an adjusted odds ratio of 1.82. Published this in pediatric in 2009 and looked to all our babies with PDA, and really there is no increased risk of necrotizing enterocolitis. In fact, in my cohort in 2009, babies with PDA, they have less NIC. There's also stuff came from University of California, San Francisco. When they stopped treating NIC, with surgeries, they would stop treating PDA, stop PDA ligation, and the end result, they have a less NIC. I just published this, came last month, PDA to treat or not to treat. So since 2008, I don't have a single baby who received a single dose of indomethacin or ibuprofen or ligation. No echo even done. And necrotizing enterocolitis did not change. Of course, BPD did not change either. So over my last 5 years, oxygen requirement at 36 weeks has been 5%. Before we stopped treatment, we used to treat was 5.8. No change in length of stay or use of duration of CPAP or mechanical ventilation. Does CPAP itself cause neck? And that had been sorted out and published that again in 2009, that really CPAP is not associated with necrotizing enterocolitis. The problem is CPAP will cause abdominal distension, then it will mask what is abdominal distension caused by CPAP versus abdominal distension caused by neck. Transfusion-related necrotizing enterocolitis is another area of controversy. 48 to 78 hours after RBCs or IVIG transfusion in babies less than 30 weeks of age, around 3 weeks of age, who are already feeding, they present with necrotizing enterocolitis, bloody stool. And proposed mechanism for transfusion-related neck: increased viscosity of blood, vasoactive mediators, inflammatory mediators, or absence of the surge in superior mesenteric blood flow that is normally expected after feed. And we have published in 2011 in relation to that. The point is, when you try to find the evidence for transfusion and necrotizing enterocolitis, even of the people who are saying transfusion is not causing neck, it is actually the anemia behind it. But regardless, there is what is causing, let's call it association. There is an association between transfusion and neck. That's clearly everybody agree about the association. But the problem is it the anemia behind that caused you to do the transfusion. But regardless, lady, for when you are talking about necrotizing enterocolitis, we need to fix this area to decrease necrotizing enterocolitis, either avoiding the anemia or being careful during giving transfusion or actually doing both. Just that would be a safe practice. Avoid anemia and transfuse. Be careful with transfusion, and I will visit that soon. There is another disease, spontaneous intestinal perforation, or what we call it SIP. Mainly babies who received indomethacin or prenatal steroids, more common in extremely low birth weight infants, and occur in the first 2 weeks of life. So you don't see a baby with spontaneous perforation after 4 weeks or 5 weeks, usually in the first week, and at the most would be the second week of life. And this is an interesting article published in 2007, and looking at in the x-axis, you see the gestational age, 23, 24, 25 weeks, and the y-axis is the percent of occurrence. So the very each column has three sectors. The highest sector is the spontaneous ileal perforation. The second sector is the dark one, that is neck surgical, and the lowest one is the neck medically treated necrotizing enterocolitis. So you can see the spontaneous perforation on top of each column are almost exclusively happen in babies 25, 24, 7 weeks. You don't see spontaneous perforation in 32-week preemie, for example. And then the surgical neck are highest again in the smallest gestational age babies. There is one other factor is allergy-related neck. Cow protein allergy. So you have a baby who all of a sudden get abdominal distension and bloody stool, and usually these babies are very stable, but they're having bloody stool. And once you stop the feed or you switch to an elemental formula, these babies will have symptoms improved. And typically, I send a stool for microscopic for eosinophilic count, and also you may find eosinophilia in the CBC. All these types of neck, you'll end up having a one common clinical presentation: apnea, bradycardia, temperature instability, lethargy, and feeding intolerance. Blood in the stool, abdominal distension more than 2 centimeters, and maybe bilious vomiting. When you say tender abdomen, just be careful. Many times, people reporting, oh, the baby's abdomen is tender. So it's not tender. You just didn't be patient. Just put your hand on the baby abdomen and start do the physical exam on the baby when your hand did not leave the abdomen. So the first touch on the abdomen, don't count that. Then leave your hand on the abdomen for a while. Then start to play with your finger and see if the baby will respond to that or not. Guarding, I really look at guarding through the movement of the knees. The baby with neck, he cannot elevate his knees up to his abdomen. You find he's moving his head right and left, he's screaming, but the knees are fixed in the bed and don't go up. This is the erythema, and then you can see the severe cases with necrosis underneath. Alarming lab values. Many times babies with neck, they have been started on sodium supplementation few days before they have neck, and of course there is acidosis. Now, what is the relevance or irrelevance of Bell's stages? Is this staging for which type of neck? Is it you're talking about a baby that you're going to switch the formula? And now, really, we have cases of neck that I'm not sure if I should start antibiotics or not. You have a baby who has bloody stool, he's perfectly fine, he doesn't have really that much of tenderness, vital sign is stable, CRP may elevate, but the CBC is fine, and then I'm really hesitant, should I start antibiotics or not? So really you start, it's important to start to find what is your best bet of this disease. Is it the protein allergy, or is this is an infectious sick baby? Or at least you may start to think of withdrawing out antibiotics for a baby who looks extremely stable, bloody stool, you stop feeding, he looks stable to you. And x-rays, of course, we can look for the nematosis. We don't have a pointer, so it will become pointless to show the x-ray. You can see around the liver where you see the nematosis, and here you can see the nematosis there. Necrosis, the brownish areas, and here the nematosis, subserosal nematosis. We see these air blips. I'm just trying to be on time. 60% mortality, 6% medically treated, and then 10 to 40% mortality, and then the complications are all well known. Prevention. Can we prevent neck? So you'll answer to me which type of neck you're talking about. And that will make it even harder on us to devise a policy to stop having necrotizing enterocolitis. But of course, the use of fresh human milk is extremely important. Early and adequate gut priming. Applying a standardized protocol, regardless of what protocol you are using. Just having a protocol will decrease necrotizing enterocolitis. Multiple papers have shown that. So we don't exceed 20 milligram ml per kg on daily increase of feed, and then check for feeding intolerance by looking for residuals, blood in the stool, and abdominal distension. Donor human milk. I brought this topic several years ago in a different conference in Jeddah and caused lots of controversy. So the WHO, the American Academy of Pediatrics, the European Society for Pediatric Gastroenterology Pathology, it began, they all recommend the use of donor human milk before considering formula in premature infants. Donor human milk is associated with reduced necrotizing enterocolitis. I put it the title in caps. This is the only slide that have caps. Donor human milk saves life. That is science. Feeding premature infants with premature formula causes 2.5-fold increased risk for necrotizing enterocolitis. If you have 30 babies, premature babies in your NICU, and two of them will have necrotizing enterocolitis, if you are feeding them premature formula, they will become three. So you have a one extra case of NIC each time you feed 33 infants with premature formula. So there are lots of discussion, even among scholars, talking now about culturally, even among scholars, there are multiple scholars you can go and check online. Multiple scholars, they are allowing giving donor milk. There are other scholars not allowing it, but medically, donor milk will decrease mortality. So should we allow him to survive and think later about marriage, or let him die now and don't worry about anything? So really, even with the respected society, you are the neonatologist in the Saudi Arabia. If we have problem with that, we can do different strategies to utilize, even if we disagree on using the common banking, we can do our own type of banking, such as identified mothers. So the baby will be receiving a one single donor breast milk from this mother, and you can tell the family that the baby, we just need to do some regulation. But the fact letting baby dies probably is not the right answer. Standardized feeding protocol, regardless of the details of the protocol, standardized feeding protocol will decrease NIC by 1 to 1/4, 22 odds ratio 0.22. So 78% of NIC can disappear if you have a standardized protocol in your NICU. That's a meta-analysis based on multiple studies. I'm going to go visit our GW protocol. It's not necessarily to be used, but just as an idea. We look for trophic feeds in the first 3 to 7 days based on birth weight. So a 1,500-grammer will receive trophic feed for 3 days. A 500-grammer will receive trophic feed for 7 days. Advanced feeds, 10
to 15. 3 minutes.
How many?
3.
Okay. Advanced feeding, every like 10 to 15 cc per kilo per day. We fortify to 22 calorie only when he reach 100 cc per kilo, and fortify to 24 calorie only when he reach 120 cc per kilo. And then we are having a feeding protocol schedule for each 100 gram. In the past, you used to say 1,000 to 1,500 gram or 500 to 1,000. That's a too huge of a range. So we have a protocol for a 500 to 600 gram, protocol for 600 to 700 gram, and just you need to get the sheet, put it at the bedside at the time of the baby's born. Feeding intolerance algorithm, this is a one we have. You just need to decide, is it bilious or non-bilious, and then what is the volume, 25% of the feed, 50% or more than 50. And then we have the sheet, so the nurse will mark this exact color for the feed, and then we'll decide in the middle that is the bilious, to the right is bilious, and to the left is non-bilious for the lower two right. Osmolarity tool, many time, so this will be at the bedside. We have a daytime and night time, and this is the clock, 12 hours. So the baby will receive 4 different medications. We never cared, used never to care about when you're giving the medication. So if the baby is receiving 4 different medications, there is no reason to have all these medication given at the same time. So actually we have calculated the osmolarity, so you can put on the clock for some medicine giving twice a day, you can say 12 midnight and 12 noon. Another medicine you can give 3 and 3, this way you avoid with the calculated osmolarity at the bedside. Use of probiotics, yes. It did decrease necrotizing enterocolitis, but we have logistical problem. Or what dose should we use, and what type of mix? How about prebiotics? This study just published, randomized control trial, I just published it this month, using honey, medically graded honey, spore-free medically graded honey. And it did cause increase after 2 weeks of application or supplementation. It has been associated with increased lactobacilli and bifidobacteria and decrease in enterobacter. Transfusion policy, if we really would like to avoid anemia, we use 40-40-40. Transfuse if hematocrit less than 40 and babies less than 1,000 grams in the first 7 days, or babies requiring 40% oxygen. Transfuse if hematocrit less than 35, babies who are less than 1,000 gram but more than 7 days old, and babies requiring 30%, 35% of oxygen. Then transfuse for less than 30 for those who are old babies who are unable to PO feed or are symptomatic. Other practice, I think that's already has been covered, the use of H2 blocker, which has no role in treatment of premature baby. So in conclusion, necrotizing enterocolitis is a multifactorial disease. It's more of a sequence of an event. Suggested strategy to reduce NIC include the use of breast milk, having a standardized feeding protocol and transfusion policy. The role of probiotic and prebiotics can be a promising solution in the near future. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Hany Aly. For the sake of time, we have only two questions max. So if anybody had a question? Yes, please, you can.
My question to Dr. Sahaf.
Sahafi.
Yes. Sahafi or
Sahaf.
Thank you for the nice review on the evidence.
Please, there is ladies, there is an announcement. Excuse me, ladies, hear me out. There is an announcement from the organizing committee regarding the lunch and the break. So please stay with us. It's important. Sorry, go ahead.
Okay, thank you. Thanks for the nice presentation and coverage on the evidence-based management and diagnosis of reflux in preterm babies. The conclusion is confusing, as you stated. But what about full-term babies who have reflux? How do we diagnose them and how do we treat them? Do we have evidence on treatment on full-term babies?
So for the full-term baby, we know that 85% of them, they have regurgitation, and the peak usually 4 to 6 months of age, and 82% of them, they will improve by 1 year of age. So there is some criteria that if the patient is not, or the baby is not growing, that means in the first 3 months that he's not growing 25 to 30 gram a day, and there is some irritability, food refusal that really indicate, then we can treat. Otherwise, if he's a heavy baby, playing, gaining weight, even if he regurgitates, that will be a stress for the family more than the baby. So we don't treat. So the criteria that usually we depend on that, even by North American Society of Pediatric Gastroenterology recommendation guidelines, that if there is any sign of disease, meaning that if there is anemia, if there is no weight gain, there is irritability or coffee ground emesis or any, then you can start treatment. But the issue there, if there is clear vomiting, that's fine, that's okay. We can do some investigation, especially for baby. Usually, we would like to do a roadmap analysis. That means we do a barium study just to check the anatomy. We don't check reflux. We don't diagnose reflux by barium. And that's very important because if the baby is fighting the study and you put a barium there, for sure it will be reflux, for sure. But because it's crying, somebody holding him, the short answer for the question that if there is a clear symptom or sign of reflux, the disease that we treat. Otherwise, if he's gaining weight, heavy, everything is fine, normal exam, normal sleeping, normal bowel habit, everything is fine, then there's no need for treatment. Some family, they push for treatment. Usually, we go for conservative things. We go for positioning. We go for thickening because it's not like a preterm. And then some of them, they come, they are heavy. Some still, they are insisting for medication. And for me, I never ever write a prokinetic agent unless there is a clear, it's a personal indication rather than scientific indication. If there is vomiting and there is, in addition to that, there is delayed gastric empty, we use one of the prokinetic for short duration only. Otherwise, I don't use it. This is simple, and yes, it's difficult, especially with pressure of the family, like it's easy to say it, difficult to apply it.
Thank you very much, everybody. Thank you, Professor. Yes, go ahead.
I just have one small clarification. The study that I did, the randomized control trial regarding positioning, I did the right lateral, not the left lateral. So the baby sleep on the liver and the stomach will be hanging up, because if you sleep on the left, you can compress the stomach and that will increase reflux. And the other two studies, they did the left lateral, they didn't show difference. But in my study, it did show difference, the right lateral.
Thank you, Prof. Hany, for this clarification. We will close our session at this time. There is an announcement from the organizing committee. Dr. Gattan?
Just a gentle, again, reminding for everybody to stick to the rules and regulation of King Faisal Halls. In this side, sorry. So the prayer will be in this side for the female. The prayer will be down for the males. Try to do your best to be away from each other, male and female. During our lunch times, the male will be in the exhibition area. The female will be in the other side in the back. Pick up your ticket here from the registration and go to the lunch. And the lunch is open from 12:30 until 2 noon times. The speaker, the moderator, they will go straight to Al Bustan restaurant. That's in the lobby of the hotels. And show you your just tags. That's enough for them, okay? And for other guests, audience, dear, please stick to the rules and regulation of the halls. Pick up your ticket, do your prayer, go for lunch, and we'll come back 1:45. 1:45, please. Thank you.